Hi folks, if you'd like to turn to Psalm 51, that's what we're looking at today. Psalm 51, it's good to be with you this afternoon. It's an honour and a privilege to share the Word of God. I'm going to pray and ask the Lord's blessing upon His Word. Father, we come before You today, and we are Your people, and we acknowledge, Father, that we need You to touch us today. So, Father, I pray that each one of us today will feed upon Your Word and will see heavenly glories and would be blessed, Lord. So, Father, we ask in the name, not of ourselves, but in the name of Your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shed His blood for us, and we ask for the power of the Holy Spirit to open our eyes, to teach us, to reveal the Word, to speak to each of our hearts today. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, these three are one. So, Father, for Your glory, may You be manifested, may You be glorified today, may You be honored today. Amen. You're the God of Isaac, You're the God of Jacob, You're the God of Abraham, You're the God of Moses, You're the living God. There's no other God but You. You are the true and living God. You're the only God. We seek no other God but You. You are the living God who created this world, who came down in our Lord Jesus Christ and died at Calvary and gave His life for us, crucified for us. This is the God we adore. This is the God we come to. And as our God, we ask that You speak to each of our hearts today. May we have a word from You. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're looking at Psalm 51. It says, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to Thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of Thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, my sin is ever before me. Against Thee, Thee only have I sinned and done this evil in Thy sight, that Thou mightest be justified when Thou speakest and be clear when Thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, Thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part Thou shalt make me know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which Thou shalt broke, that Thou hast broken, may rejoice. Hide Thy face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from Thy presence, and take not Thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of Thy salvation, and uphold me with Thy willing spirit. Then will I teach transgressors Thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto Thee. Deliver me from blood guiltlessness, O God. Thou God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of Thy righteousness. O Lord, open Thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth Thy praise. For Thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offering. The sacrifice of God and a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, Thou wilt not despise. Do good in Thy good pleasure unto Zion, and build Thou the walls of Jerusalem. Then shall Thou be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness, with the burnt offering and all burnt offering. Then shall Thy offer bullocks upon Thy altar." When We're looking at the teaching of repentance towards God. Repentance towards God. The nation and the church are reveling in sin. There's no shame in our eyes anymore for sin. Morality has been turned upside down. That which we say is right is wrong. That which is wrong, we say is right. We've turned everything upside down morally. And that is in the church as well. The church has become cowardly and worldly. And the thing that we need most of all back in the church, back in our nation, is the doctrine of repentance. What is repentance? Kittel says in his dictionary, repentance is a radical conversion, a transformation of nature, a definite turning up from evil, and a resolute turning to God in total obedience. A definite turning from evil and a resolute turning to God in total obedience. Kittel. We need the doctrine of repentance back in our churches, amen. Back in our own personal life, back in our family life, back in our national life. So is it biblical? It sounds a bit old-fashioned, Jim, but is the doctrine of repentance biblical? Matthew chapter 3, verse 8 says, bring forth therefore fruit meet for repentance. By John the Baptist. Our Lord said, from that time Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Matthew 4:17. And Acts 3:19, St. Peter said, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come for the presence of the Lord, from the presence of the Lord. So repentance is biblical. So I know we don't have any smart alecks here, smart aleck theologians who have got PhDs and think they're clever with philosophy and are going into the ministry. But if there's any smart aleck theologians that are listening, the Bible says repentance, repentance. It doesn't matter how clever you are, that's what the Bible says, and that's what we'll have. The Bible, what the Bible says. We don't want your philosophy. We don't want your clever ideas. We want the simple Bible, the simple Word of God. And today we've become half-hearted with sin. We're playing around with sin on the television. Television is awash with things that are ungodly. The standards of the television have come right down morally. In the press has become immoral in the actions and the things that it says. Our politicians have become immoral and have come down in their standards. Our judiciary have come down in their standards. Our police force have come down in their moral standards. Our family life has come down in its moral standards. We tolerate things that we would not have tolerated 20 years ago. Our standards in national life can be explained by a guy who was in Manchester on a stag do in the afternoon, I was told. And he was holding a big balloon, a sex object, in the middle of Manchester in the afternoon, 12 o'clock, with little kiddies running around. 20 years ago, fathers would have walked up to him and given him a slap, saying, what's this? This is nonsense. You see, you said, Jay, you're doing my head in. You're laboring this immorality in the nation. Well, it's a fact. It's a fact, my friend. You need to wake up. We need to wake up. We've been mired in sin all across the board in our land. all across the board in the church, all across the board in our family, all across the board. Sin has come in and it's there and we don't care about it anymore. We've got used to it. Even in the church. The church has got used to sin. Brother, could you turn to 2 Samuel chapter 11? 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 1 to 4, brother, if you could find that before. So number one, King David sinned. Psalm 51 is about a man who repents. It's about a man deep down in his heart repents. And we're going to learn what repentance is. And our brother in a minute is going to read 2 Samuel 11, 1, 4. Before you do, I just want to say, King David sinned. King David sinned.
Amen.
In 1945, we had the GI soldiers from America come over to England. Do you remember? The GI guys. And they came over, and they were in the north of England, and we had what is called the GI brides, because the GI soldiers came over here, started dancing with our ladies, started marrying them. But some of these ladies in the UK were married, and their soldiers, their husbands, were away fighting in France, fighting in Germany, yet the GI soldiers were dancing with the English ladies and marrying them and having sex with them, when the ladies and the soldiers should have been concentrating on the war effort rather than partying. That's what we see with David. David should have been at war, but instead he was at home and he saw Bathsheba and he lusted after Bathsheba. We're going to read it now. 2 Samuel 11, 1 to 4. Thank you, brother.
At the turn of the year, when kings go out to battle, David sent Joab out with his other officers and all of them Israelite force, and they ravaged Ammon and laid siege to Rabbah. David remained in Jerusalem. And one evening, as he got up from his couch and walked about on the roof of the palace, he saw from there a woman bathing, and she was very beautiful. He made inquiries about the woman and was told it must be Bathsheba, daughter of Eliam and wife of Uriah the Hittite. He sent messengers to fetch her, and when she came to him, he had intercourse with her, though she was still purifying herself after a period, and then she went home.
Thank you, brother. So David should have been at war with his men. His men were at war. But David was not at war. He was at home, and while he was on the roof, he looked over the roof and he saw Bathsheba. And she looked nice. And he's the king. And he's going to have her. And he had her. But she was married. Now, Uriah, her husband, David had to do something about it because now she's pregnant. And if Uriah finds out, he's going to be in trouble. So what he does, he says to Joab, he said, look, send Uriah into the battle where it's going to be fierce so I know he's going to get killed. And that's what he did. He sent Uriah into battle where it was really tough and Uriah got killed. So David, who should have been at war, ends up sleeping with a woman that's not his and ends up getting a guy killed. All because he should have been at battle, but he was playing around. I want to concentrate on that in a second, but I just want to point to this, that his sin, first sin, was sexual sin. Flee, 1 Corinthians 6:8, flee from sexual immorality. Every other sin a person commits is outside the body, but the sexually immoral person sins against his own body. Hebrews 13:4. Let marriage be held in honor among all, and let the marriage bed be undefiled, for God will judge the sexually immoral and adulterous. Hebrews 13:4. Sexual sin is a great danger. It's the central issue here. So if we're not busy in the Lord's work, if we're not busy realizing we're in a battle, we only have to switch off 1 minute and we can fall into sin. You could be at work, and some man or lady, you're married, and some man flirts to you, or some woman flirts to you, you give them the phone number, then they text you, then the next thing you know, you're in a relationship that you should be in, and you were married already. You could be a guy, you sat down at the computer late at night, you end up going on Facebook, then you end up watching something else you shouldn't watch, because you switched off. Yeah? We're in a battle. And we can't rest, we can't sit down. Sexual sin led David to murder, it led him to hide his sin, and it led a prophet, Nathan, to challenge David. Nathan came up to David and told him a story about a lamb, that this lamb was stolen from a poor family, and David was really angry. And then Nathan the prophet said, yeah, but you went and stole the only wife of Uriah. Nathan rebuked David, and David realized he'd sinned. But you know something about David's sin? God is wonderfully merciful. But David, when he sinned, he had a baby by Bathsheba, and that baby died. And not only that, he had a son called Absalom, and Absalom raised up against David. And Absalom ended up sleeping with David's wife. In other words, if you sin, if you play around with sin, it will come somewhere along the line and bite you. And sin often tricks us, and we think there's no consequences to this sin. I'll just play around with this sin. But you can't play around with a rattlesnake. You can't play around with a scorpion. But we play around with it. My brothers and sisters, never switch off. You're a 24-hour soldier of Christ.
Amen.
Whether you're at the office, whether you're at the church, whether you're on the computer, wherever you are, you are 24 hours a day, born again, warrior for God. And if you switch off, you'll fall. You'll fall into sin. And the consequences will be horrific. He's merciful. He'll forgive you. But there are consequences. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Ephesians 6:11. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. You are a 24-hour warrior for Jesus. There's never a day off from Jesus. There's never a time when you switch off. You are to be on guard every day, every hour, every minute, and you will stay strong. But David switched off for 1 hour. He switched off for 1 hour. He should have been at war. For 1 hour, he had a rest. And for that 1 hour, he slept with Bathsheba and ended up killing a guy who was his best mate. Number two. So we looked at King David's sin. King David was convicted of his sin. King David was convicted of his sin. If you turn to Psalm 51, verse 3, it says, "For I acknowledge my transgression." Here it is. "My sin is ever before me." Verse 5, "Behold, I was shaped in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." You see, he's admitting his guilt now. Verse 9, "Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities." He's being honest with himself. Verse 14, "Deliver me from blood guiltless, O God, thou God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness." We hear words like iniquity, sin, transgression. He's admitting his guilt. on the Jeremy Kyle show. Have you ever seen the Jeremy Kyle show?
It's your fault.
Everybody's blaming everybody else. Nobody's taking any responsibility. Nobody's saying, it's me, I did it, it's my fault, oh, me, no.
Your fault, not me.
David didn't go, it's your, David went, no, it's me. I did it. I went and slept with her, I went and did it. I should not have done it, I slept with Bathsheba, it was me. It wasn't because I wasn't well, it wasn't because I was depressed, it wasn't because I was just feeling a bit low, it was because I lusted after her, I am the sinner, and I rebelled against God, it was me. Took responsibility for his sin. And you've got to take responsibility for what you do wrong. It's no good saying it was her, it was him, it was because I wasn't well. Yeah, we know we're not. Sometimes we're not well, sometimes we get depressed. But at the end of the day, sometimes we do things wrong and we know we shouldn't do it. And we have to be honest about it. I sinned. Sorry, God. Imagine you're married to a guy or a lady, whatever sex, if you're a man, you're married to the lady, if you're a lady, you're married to the man. But imagine you're married, and your spouse gets Alzheimer's. You know Alzheimer's, that disease that peppers the brain, and they just don't know what's going on anymore. That's what Alzheimer's does. So you're married to this person and their brain just goes, it's just gone, they've got Alzheimer's. And while they've got Alzheimer's, they're swearing at you, they're hitting you, they're doing horrible things against you. And then one day, the doctor rings up and says, we've got a cure for your Alzheimer's, for your spouse. So you go to the doctor and the doctor gives the tablet to the person. And then next day, they're cured of their Alzheimer's. And now you tell them, you know, for the last 3 months you've been swearing at me, you've been hitting at me, you've been doing all sorts of terrible things to me, you know. And then you go, they go, oh, I love you so much, and I did that. I love you so much, and I hit you, and I swore at you, and oh. And it's because they love you. It's because they care about you, they're brokenhearted, that they actually did those things against you. Well, in a way, sin's like Alzheimer's. Sin is a crazy thing. And David began to wake up, he began to see, I love God. I really love God. Why did I do this with Bathsheba? I love God. Verse 4, listen to how he's realizing. It's about God. He's hurt God in this sin. Against thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou might be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest. You see, he's waking up. He's realizing, I've hurt my God in all this. Verse 10. Look at verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. You see, it's about God. He's referring to God. Verse 14. Deliver me from blood guiltless, O God. You see, it's a God again. Thou God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness. It's about God. Verse 17. The sacrifice, here it is again. The sacrifice of what? Of God. And a broken spirit and a broken and contrite heart. Oh God, thou wilt not despise. You see, when we sin and play around with sin, and it has consequences, ultimately it affects the one we love. It affects God.
Amen.
And our nation has lost its understanding of God. It's forgotten God. It doesn't know God. The God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the God who saved us in the Second World War, is forgotten God, and so he can't repent because he's forgotten him. And in the church has got small views of God, so the church plays around with sin. And we play around with sin. But when the nation, and when you, and when the church begin to meditate on who God is, that God is the Creator, that God is the Almighty, that God is holy, that God has not left us wrong, that God is all-powerful, all-glorious, all-majestic, He's not left this universe, is here. When we realize it's God who's great, we begin to realize, I've messed up. So God, forgive me. You are living God, and I've gone and sinned here. Forgive me. The nation will go, oh God, forgive us. How did we do this? Why did we do this as a politicians? Why did we do this? We forgot Him, the living God, Jehovah Jireh. We forgot Him. Amen. And in our own lives, when we realize, I love God. Why am I doing this? Why am I doing this sin? It's breaking His heart. You will not sin. You will repent. And David's love for God broke his heart. And he said, my heart breaks. Why am I doing this to my God? Forgive me, God. David wants to be with God more than anything else. Look at verse 11 and 12. Cast me not away from thy presence. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Uphold me with thy willing spirit. He wants God more than anything. He's pursuing God more than anything. And that's when we get out of the mire. That's when we get out of sin. That's when we get out of the pit. When we begin to desire God more than anything. More than our sin. God is the arm that will hold you at your weakest, the eye that will see you at your darkest, and the heart that will love you at your worst. God is the arm that will hold you at your weakest, the eye that will see you at your darkest, and the heart that will love you at your worst. It's when we see God we begin to repent.
Amen.
And then finally, King David's forgiveness for his sin. Imagine someone came up to you, we're nearly finished now. Imagine someone come up to you and they murdered someone. They phone the police are going to get them, come down and pick them up. Before the police get there, they knock on your door and they say to you, look, I've murdered someone. Can I be forgiven? What would you say? David murdered someone. Psalm 51 verse 1. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Blot out my transgressions. Verse 9. Hide thy face from my sins. And here it is. Notice, blot out my iniquities. What does it mean by blot out? You get a piece of paper in the time of David, and David would write, or someone would write on a piece of paper, and the ink would be a blot. It would stick. It would just be a pile of a blot on the paper. And when that happened, you couldn't wipe it out. It was just, you tried to wipe it out, but it would make a mess of the paper. So when David says, blot out my transgressions, if you had a piece of paper in his day with a blot of ink on it, if you could get rid of it, it would be a miracle. And what David is saying is God can do a miracle. He can blot out my sins. He can forgive me.
Amen.
And any sin you've ever done, however deep, however bad, however much you have done it regular, however deep it's been, you can be forgiven today. You can be clean today. He will forgive you. He will restore you. He restored David. Verse 12. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Uphold me with thy willing spirit. It doesn't matter how many times you've fallen. You could have been a prostitute for 40 years and slept with thousands of guys. If you repent today, you can be forgiven. You can be a wife who's been nagging at your husband for a month. And if you repent now, you can be forgiven. You can be a husband who's been a pain in the neck to the wife. If you repent, you can be forgiven right now. Every single one of us can have a new start today. Whatever you've done, however deep it is, however much you've failed,